Leah, welcome. Fair, welcome as well. Oh, he's almost there. He's going to come in a second. Fair, thanks. Of course, when I will, maybe I will ask first that Leah and Fair can quickly introduce themselves because we haven't seen them yet on the screen here today. Leah, maybe to start with you.
Well, hi everyone. I think I was part of last remarketing track, so a lot of you might know us. Czech is the AI from inspection to remarketing, and I'm the co-founder of Czech since 2017. We are also based in Europe and throughout Europe. Thanks for welcoming us.
Okay. Fair.
Good afternoon. My name is Fair Ewart. I'm the European Fleet Manager for Infor. We are a large IT company using multiple vehicles to Europe.
Okay, Fair. Thanks for joining. Maybe we will start with Leah, as you've heard before in the first presentation. Bertrand was talking a lot about seamless integration of different service providers to see that 3 + 3 + 3 becomes 9. What types of integration does a company like Czech can provide in these type of systems?
Well, I agree with the Bertrand that innovation needs to be integrated into a process, and integration might be key. Innovation, as we have with Czech, is a guarantee also of performance and sustainability of how to compete in this challenging moment. And when it comes to integration or when it comes to quality service, groups must compete. So I think there is a first phase of innovation where groups might try innovation to reinforce the existing process or try a new process. But at another time, I agree with Bertrand, at some point, things need to be centralized for the existing process. A group needs to compete with reinvention and innovation. And interoperability with the API, so Czech is quite open. I mean, we can be integrated into the process, and this is also the case with MacDam. Groups work together with each other, and there's constant watch of techniques on how to do better and to provide the end customer also the best process. And this is why solutions need to constantly evolve into the your process that has well been described by Bertrand.
Okay. Okay. Thanks. Maybe over for the first one to Fer. I know that you you are involved with a lot of the activities of Fleet Europe. You're in the global fleet. You're in the IFME. You know a lot of your colleagues, of course. And today, I'm sure that you will be the voice almost of all of them. Now, maybe you can explain your challenge or the fleet managers' challenge with the aspect of the inspection and the charges that might occur and come afterwards.
Sure. Thanks for inviting me for the panel discussion. And let me first give the compliments to the appraisal companies. Mm-hmm. The Macadams, the Dekras, the TÜV, they're doing exactly what we are asking. Give us a fair competition overview of the vehicles when they are returned at the end of the life cycle. So the reports we're coming are clear, they are visual, and everything is noted. But the challenge we are facing is are the following. I watched the presentation of Wolfgang, where he introduced the Fair VNT guide. And the Fair VNT guide is not always matching the reports we are receiving. And what we are noticing, and that has also to do with the following. Internal, a lot of companies, a lot of colleagues in fleet management responsible for the fleet in Europe, they've got an internal car policy, where, for example, certain responsibilities is transferred to the drivers concerning damages, concerning the general use of the vehicle. But receiving lately the latest reports we have shows that the charges coming in aren't quite fair, to be honest. and it's more seeking a kind of a revenue for the lease vendor to gain on possible less value losses. What Wolfgang also mentioned is that the market was under pressure and therefore the fair variant here was introduced. I can partly follow that item, but when you ask a lease vendor to calculate a vehicle, they are the experts on the rest value. And it's difficult to interpret a rest value for a car which will be returned after 4 years. You got the legislation change, we have the diesel item, previously we had the export possibilities. So we are charged for possible losses at the end of the term by charging on the fair VNT guide provided. And I've got so many examples. We take the Wolfgang is mentioning about the maintenance of the cars or the tire profile theft of the tires at the end of the return. You bring a car for maintenance at the end of the life cycle, it is refused. But at the end, when the car is returned, I get the invoice. So is that fair? Yeah, that's the question. When you have got a car with components returned, and just a stupid thing is a few euro, you return a car with a compressor as you didn't have got a spare tire, but also including the repair kit you never used, but the repair kit has got a date, and the date is expired, so you will be charged for the repair kit. Suspension parts, where no one can see certain normal wear on the suspension part, where you get charges for. Dense stone pits. So many examples I have to say, okay, there's a point where the lease vendor is not following the fair VNT guide. And the challenge we are facing is, when there's a damage to a car, the majority of all my colleagues say, yes, charge them, because it's the blame of the employee, and the employee will be charged for the franchise or the damage or whatever. But to charge a certain expense where you say this car is 4 years old, driven 160,000 kilometers, you get an invoice of 3,000 euro on stone pits, I don't think this is not really fair. That's also calculated into the rest value of the vehicle. And it's very difficult to explain to your drivers from here's an invoice coming. So the expenses we have in fleet and over years, the protocols are getting more expensive due to an increase of labor, due to an increase of parts. Where you say, okay, is this still an appropriate way to examine the vehicles, but to get the charges to the fleet owners? And that's the question we have, and that's also a debate. And the expenses are getting really, really high.
Well, I think this is certainly an item where all of the experts can reply to. Maybe first back to Wolfgang, because you have been in this for years. And of course, you have a lot of contact with CARA. I remember where all the inspection companies are in, all the lease companies. So what's your take on this, or what's your view on this currently?
I mean, first of all, I see your point there. It is quite important that, for example, you sign a contract with a lease company. The first car is terminating 3 or maybe 4 years later. Is everybody still knows what's going on? My advice here is take a fair wear and tear report as part of the contract. Sign every single page where you see the pictures, accepted, not accepted. That is one part. On the other side, you should see whatever is the measurements on the pricing. What I've done in the past is you always have to calculate the price on the new spare parts, on the new price. The labor cost you cannot change. This is in. But then when your car is 4 years old, you should have a depreciation on the parts. For example, a Renault Kangoo, 400,000 kilometers after 6 years, and the spare part will cost you, say, 1,000 euros. That should be then charged by 100 or 50, and not by 1,000 and not by 500. If it comes to a new car, 6 months old, and there's something broken, then of course you can charge it by 60%. This is sort of a depreciation list, which you can organize with your leasing company, and then you are on a safer side. And then of course, with the new technology, like we see with Czech, is not a driver who is not a person who is inspecting the cars. And I had that old experience. One day after St. Patrick's Day in Ireland, don't trust any fair wear and tear report, because the driver or the inspector is still on 3 promille alcohol, which is okay over there. And if you do it on artificial intelligence, the machine is not drinking, and therefore it's always correct. And you are coming very close into the corridor where you come up to a 95% security that only this is charged what is happening on the car. The perfect way, but this more on technique, the car should be returned as is described in the Fair and Tear report, and there's no charge. But it's more a wishful dreaming, and it costs your time when you send your driver around in a garage to repair it or to fix it. This is not the solution, but it should be fair. That is from my point of view. I'm doing it now for over 30 years. In inspection reports starting in Germany, fair is the key word. And everybody should understand what fair means.
Okay, quite clear now. Fair, unfair, and maybe it's a bit unfair now, but I would like to go back to Bertrand, because I can imagine that you're in the middle of those things almost every day. I think in the past you told me every complaint you get is almost always there about the different views of a fleet manager versus lease company or something. So how do you handle this? How do you manage this?
Well, the role of an inspection company is to notify what they see, and to transpose that to a cost which is fair but in line with the contract. That is basically your job, and we do it quite right. We have over 99% of no claims, and in the 1% claims we receive, 50% of it are basically not an inspection issue or for an interpretation issue. So I understand fair. I know what he's telling, but and I like when he says that we try to do the utmost and we achieve to do it the utmost, and I understand his frustration. But when you come up to a and that is basically the point. The people we meet, and we do quite a lot of inspections, about 50% of our inspections are together with the driver. The drivers are not aware of any fair wear and tear pollution. And basically, they are causing the possible damages. And I don't speak about maintenance and so on, but we all have anecdotes and examples where people drove with slick tires, never did maintenance and so on, and that is not the way a good father should handle his car. And that education, we take it up as our role, and we train our inspectors just to explain what Wolfgang explained, what is fair and what is not fair. Mm-hmm. And not only be technically excellent, but also to be commercially very comprehensive. But on the other hand, we have a contract, we have a handbook, and this one has to be followed.
Okay, no.
And it sets us needs sometimes between the hammer and the thing you hit on and the nail, because sometimes you just have angry persons before you, especially private lease customers that we're getting there. And there are other techniques to be done, but education is very important, both in fleet and in private lease.
Now, coming back maybe to Lea about this artificial intelligence, we've learned today that they don't take any alcohol, which is good.
Yeah.
But how could... do you think this will create more, I don't know, a transparency, visibility, whatever, so that it could support a better understanding between all parties?
Well, AI will not change the contract. I think what Bertrand is saying is that there is a main contract of what is fair, what is not fair, and AI will not change what is based in the contract. Apart from that, I think AI brings kind of two things, two main goals. The first one, yes, is productivity and not drinking alcohol, Wolfgang. So outperforming human performance. And the second one is interactivity, meaning there's a neutral information to base our exchange, to base our interactivity. And that's yes, the goal of the AI. So I think there's not to separate the contract or the commercial approach of what is shared to the end user and what AI can do for the process and optimizing the process with neutral information. Yes.
I'm sure, Fer, that you have followed a bit of this automated inspection element. Do you see any advantage there, or does the challenge stay the same?
No, to be honest, no. And that's maybe a little bit rude, Elia, but we tried over the past period to make sure that the variant here would be implemented and used as it should be. So what we did is some pilot projects where we said, okay, let's use an expertise company or an examinator and let's compare reports. The first thing the vendor did, our lead vendor did, said, no, we don't recognize this report because this is not an official registered appraisal company, so we will not use it. Okay, I've got here a self scan where we've got also a report of the vehicle. And the same answer came in. They are completely following the guidance provided in case of Maya, in this case Macadam is in on board, or the DECRA or the TÜV, and they're using those protocols. And when I say protocols, when you examine a car in position A and you examine a car in position B in a different city, besides the fact that the labor could be different, you should expect to have a similar report. But there are also huge differences in between the same organization. I even took it that far that I say, okay, let's have a car, let's completely repaint the car where damages are, so return it. Even then I got an invoice because the car was repaired. They said, hey, it's repaired, possible a damage, there's no track record, so you got an additional depreciation. So whatever you do, it seems that, and that's the experience we have, but also we're discussing into the global fleet, but also Fleet Europe, is the lead vendor wants to make money. And that's the overall expression we have. And that's nothing to do with the job Macadam is doing or TÜV is doing, or with all respect to the variant guide. It's just using it as at the moment to cover up their possible losses in the future. And that's, I don't think, and I think it's a signal also to the lease vendors. And we did that during some sessions. I think maybe Macadam and Wolfgang can assist. Leah, you can also assist. That this is an heads up for the lease vendor from, okay, when fleet is noticing this and the expenses are getting that high, that we are seeking for alternatives. And alternatives that can be saying, okay, let's move away completely from company vehicles, find something else. But what Bertrand is mentioning, when you then skip over to private leases, you're coming into the same the situation that you then transfer this issue, this problem, to your employees. And I don't think that's also an act of employer responsibility, that you want to protect your employees, to keep them happy and pleased working for the company. So it's an item where there should be a mutual solution coming in. And that's my point.
Yeah, Fred. Well, I think of course the a lot of lease companies are exploring AI based systems or starting to explore this. So I think we can hope and maybe see whether there is an evolution there. Maybe a question to Wolfgang: the implementation of a consistent approach by different leasing companies in every country. Are there still opportunities to maybe do something with CARA or almost have a working group? I'm just inventing now with lease companies and a few fleet managers or something. Are there things that still can be done? Because it's really it seems to be an important aspect there. Of course.
What we did in 2018 with CARA is that we took the high level on all different kind of leasing companies or associations. What we are having is an overall umbrella. We are not in heavily details because, first of all, it is different from country to country, not massively, but smaller. And on the other side, what we don't want to do is that we're saying this panel should cost 100 euro and this part should cost 300 euros, because then you do it all over Europe, totally different. And then there's a list, nobody can see that. What we have is a recommendation, how it should work. I checked that with the Belgium with Rentas. I checked that with the DVLA in the UK. I checked it with in Germany. The differentiation from our approach, the CARA approach, to whatever is in the countries is less than 5%. And if you go on pricing, it's very simple. Spare parts are not extremely different in pricing throughout Europe. Eastern Europe is maybe a little bit different, but Central Europe is more or less the same price. And look at Bertrand, who's even the expert. He's seeing the same. The only price difference is heavily, heavily on labor cost. I go from, I think Finland is 120 euros an hour or even more. You go to Romania, it will 20 euros. That is a big difference that you have for labor cost. And I go a little bit back when Germany was East and West Germany. We had a 40 euro in East Germany and we had 100 euro or 80 euro in West Germany. And then, of course, if you want to make it easy, you take then the average of 60 euros. It is not 100% fair, but thanks God, this East and West Germany is over. Now the East learned from the West that the highest price is always the best. And now it's the same level. But that's the only thing you have to put. But you can put that in systems and you can make it transparent. And for you, fair is first of all, a leasing company and whoever from leasing company is listening, the fair wear and tear should not be an additional income to bring up to your profit and loss line. It should be really used for the damages and for the complication you have on the car. That's very clear, very simple. If you don't do it, it's cheating. Just use this hard word. And there is a couple of elements there where you can use the measurements that I mentioned before. You line up your main problems, that it will not a problem, that you say it is on page number 8, it's on page number 20, it's this depreciation table, and then you are on a fairer side. And whoever fleet managers who are listening into this the audience, I would recommend the same to them.
Okay.
Look at the CARA website and look at the CARA fair and tear. I think that's an acceptable guideline throughout Europe.
That's what you mentioned. It should be accepted and it should be in a fair position. And Absolutely. For us, it's very simple. When there's a damage, we will never, never deny there was a damage. Even worse. And it's with cleaning of cars, with everything. And that is written in our internal protocols.
And Fer, I follow your point. There are some really things that sometimes are maybe over the top, but basically, and we follow the number of damages and the consistency between the inspectors and how they work. And we see that most of the damages, over 95% of the damages, are always the same and are basically caused by the driver. This is the front right bumper, the rear back left wing, alloy rims, and so on. And as a fleet manager, if you want to reduce costs, of course you need to apply a fair wear and tear. But I really believe that an education of the drivers should be set in place, because they need to be aware that a small scratch of 10 centimeters over 10 centimeters has an impact on the pricing of the car. And we all know that as professionals, but I don't know if the especially the private drivers, but the fleet drivers as well, know that also. And often you see that big damaged vehicles are basically just the condition or the attitude of the driver, rather than the leasing company that is charging too much.
You're right on that one, and it's you have to arm yourself as a company. And what we did is, when we introduced our fleet or renewed our fleet, we said, okay, what is the liability and responsibility for the driver? Let's identify first. And I can say the lease fare is too expensive, you're charging too much for the insurance company, a premium, and the fare interior is the damages are insane. Now, first identify what is in our presence and what are the wishes we have for our MPs and what is mandatory for them to follow. And that's the first step. And that's what we implemented in our company. When we did that, and we transferred a part of this responsibility, and it's not a penalizing employees, but just this responsibility. This is a property, and it costs 30, 40, 50, 60, or 80,000 euro. You use it for 4 years, please take care of it. Something can happen, accident can happen, it's insured, but make sure that you take care of this property, inside, outside. That's the regulation we have. Wolfgang.
Fair. Simple, funny, stupid thing. Make a sticker on the board book and say, please treat your company car as you treat your girlfriend, your dog, your wife, or whatever you like.
Are you sure, Wolfgang?
And at least I will see it at least once a month, and they will ring a bell. And last thing I would like to say, don't blame on any macadams or whoever is turbo. You mentioned that before. They're sitting in the middle. They're only doing what is contract between the leasing company. They're not contracted with you as a customer. And therefore, the bottleneck is not the fair and tear company. The bottleneck is then the owner of the car, what's mainly the leasing company.
Yeah, but that's, I'm not blaming the macadam. What I started, they're doing a wonderful job. They give a condition of the car, which we can use for our drivers to see if, hey, you returned your car. Perfect. It's in perfect condition. But it's then a bit silly when you say, driver, you did a perfect job, that you get an, there's a charge coming up for 600 or 700 euro for 4 years, 150,000 kilometers. This is perfect. And that you then get a charge from the lease fund. Hey guys, we will charge you for 700 euro because the stone pits are overdone. Okay, but when I look at the stone pit, explain to me why this is overdone. No, you have to pay for it. So the flexibility, and that's an agreement we built up with the lease vendor. We say, okay, let's do the following. We will not negotiate up front with our lease rate, but we will have got a reduction of fair VAT expenses. So you make an agreement also with your lease vendor to avoid such kind of charges. Remember, leasing is outsourcing all issues, risk, everything into a certain limit on maintenance, repair, and on your insurance cost, on your rest value. That one thing is not our core business. We want to make a lease vendor services during the period of time. And we pay a certain amount based on the budgeted mileage we have and the budgeted period. And that's what we are asking from our lease vendor, that the rules are changing over time. We are aware of it. What you mentioned with the electrification, with the rest values on batteries, and that's the second step. But the current situation, we see that the rules are now changing in a way that we say, is this still acceptable? Do you want to accept it from the lease vendor in the place? And therefore, I say, I need the help. I still need the reports. But I need to have a clear vision. When I look at the fair VAT guide from Clara, I say, this is something, this is a guidance, and the guidance should be used by everyone. And when there is a dispute, you can debate about it together with your vendor. But macadam is not a part of it because they are doing exactly what is asked. But the agreement between macadam and the lease vendor, that can be a different agreement.
I'm sure that we are going to keep on going for another hour because it's a great debate and it's a great discussion. I think we can, if I can summarize, I think there are agreed guidelines. I think there can be more emerging towards applying it and maybe a bit more consistency. AI can further enable the fact that it becomes more visible. And of course, in this more complex world, if everything gets more and more integrated, hopefully we can, or the remarketing industry can improve everything. And I'm 100% aligned with Ian's comment in the chat. And I think it was overall a very honest, straightforward, and nice approach. Thanks, all of you, Lea, Bertrand, Wolfgang, Fer.